I arranged to go to the UK to meet experts who would be well qualified to advise us on the way forward. On the 5th of September 2008, I went to Oxford with our forensic services manager and other staff, and at the headquarters of LGC Forensics met with Carl Harrison, their lead scientist, National Policing Improvement Agency Homicide Search Advisors, and forensic staff representing forensic archaeology and anthropology, as well as a cadaver dog advisor. We had already asked Mr. Harrison to prepare a desk-based study brief of Haut de la Garenne, and he circulated this at the meeting. The decision made at this meeting was that we should carry out an initial reconnaissance of the site over a short period to seek to clarify a number of objectives. It was decided that we would deploy several different assets to be deployed in a systematic fashion using best value and best practice guidelines. In simple terms, we wanted to establish if there was anything there which would need further investigation, or if we could walk away from it without further investigation. 2 weeks later, we moved into the grounds of Haut de la Garenne. We deployed geophysical assets and ground-penetrating radar in order to identify anomalous areas for further investigation. We also used gridded probing techniques to assist the dogs, and of course we had the anecdotal evidence of witnesses and victims. We decided we would not at any time carry out speculative searching, but would deploy the forensic and archaeology assets in areas where there was corroboration that something needed further investigation. Before we excavated, we would give full consideration to possible explanations given by earlier work or utilities. We also studied in depth building plans and maps. It was during this process that builders who had worked on the site told us that a few years before, they had found bones they were convinced were human, but had been told to forget them and let bygones be bygones. This phrase became a catchword amongst my team whenever the subject of attempt at cover-up would arise. One worker was so convinced they were human, he took them home to examine them against computer images, which only strengthened his fears. Eventually, these bones were examined by a Jersey pathologist after police had called her to the home. She told the officer, "I don't like the look of this," but was later to say she could not remember making that comment. She was not saying it wasn't made, but just couldn't remember it. She took the bones to her boss, who's extremely short, 5 lines report, said the bones were too large to be human, but also stated that one of the bones could not identify it. He gave the measurements of the bones, and our anthropologist took issue with his findings, saying that the size of the bone concerned was within the size range of a child. Unfortunately, the bones were destroyed by the pathologist without being examined by an anthropologist. Our advice was that they should have been so examined, as the pathologist was not qualified to rule on whether or not they were human. The builders told us that they had found 2 child's shoes with the bones. The pathologist told us that he had sent them for examination and had been told they were Victoria. The person he said he sent them to remembered no such incidents. Unfortunately, the shoes too had been destroyed, and were unavailable to us. At the same time as we were digesting this deeply puzzling sequence of events, we received a positive reaction from the dog trained to find traces of human remains. This reaction came at the same spot as the builders had found the bones mentioned above. At this point, I took the decision to authorise the archaeologists to dig at that location. I would do the same again. It beggars belief, and I am at a loss to imagine why Mr. Gradwell and David Walkup should say that they would have taken a different decision. To me, that would be gross negligence. My decision was fully endorsed by the ACPO team who were mentoring us, and this team included the former head of the Met Homicide Department and a vastly experienced senior investigating officer. It was also unanimously supported by all of my senior team, including the UK Homicide Search Advisors. The dig was necessary because there were matters which needed further investigation. Indeed, the advice of the ACPO homicide team was that we had no choice but to treat the scene as one of potential homicide. This advice was expressed frequently, and I know it was given to Frank Walker.